New Zealand is the country with the highest number of cars per capita in the world. As we saw earlier, there are 860 cars in New Zealand per 1,000 people. That's nearly one car for every person in the country. Auckland itself is highly car dependent, and this is reflected in statistics like the autos per capita, and that Aucklanders spend an average of 80 hours per year in congestion. That's two full work weeks per person in congestion. Some of this can be attributed to the nature of the region's land uses. Outside the CBD, substantial parts of the region are characterized by low-density residential land uses that are serviced by low-density commercial land uses. These development patterns make it very inefficient and expensive to serve with public transport. The road networks serve as more than a conduit to move people between home, jobs, and shopping. They are also critical infrastructure for freight movements. The manufacturing, wholesale, and retail trades all rely heavily on efficient movement along arterials. Delays in travel time can have significant economic consequences for sectors that combined account for 36% of regional GDP and 40% of the region's employment. So what are the many functions that arterials serve? First of all, freight movement. The movement of goods by road encompasses every part of the road network, from large trucks on state highways to small delivery trucks on local roads. Additionally, the Port of Auckland is a major generator of container traffic, a very high percentage of which has an origin or destination south of the port facilities. To elaborate, the area around the airport is developing as an import-export consolidation area, but is also the base of major transport operations. There's a concentration of commercial and industrial activity around Wiri that generates significant heavy vehicle trips. This includes the Petroleum Product Distribution Center at the end of Wiri Station Road. Arterial roads obviously don't just accommodate freight movement. When planned right, arterials can move a significant number of people very efficiently. The greater people moving capacity of dedicated bus lanes when sufficient service frequency is provided provides the rationale for prioritizing more road space for passenger transport in the future. The large majority of bus lanes to date have been created through removing on-street curbside parking during weekday morning or evening peak periods. Outside of the peak periods, the arterial functions as a two-lane road, one lane per direction, with curbside parking. In the future, the removal of curbside parking simply won't be enough space to accommodate the potential demand for bus prioritization. Additional bus lanes will increasingly require removing a lane of moving traffic or local road widening. Obviously, it's much more sustainable, better for the environment, if travel can be conducted without using a motorized vehicle. In this case, arterials can act as a major conduit for active travel. Some cyclists, despite what type of infrastructure exists, will choose to cycle on arterials, and a basic level of service should be provided on all arterials. Design guidelines for cycle facilities are provided in Austro Roads Guide to Traffic Engineering Practice, Part 14, titled Bicycles, and the New Zealand Supplement, which are available on the Course Canvas site. Bicycles are permitted to use bus and transit lanes, and this can provide the opportunity of catering for both forms of transport in some instances. The most common kind of bike infrastructure is the cycle lane, which is a lane marked exclusively for cycle use using an edge line plus cycle symbols at regular intervals. While it is cheap and easy to add bike lanes to a road, simple paint does not provide protection to riders. More protective lanes include rubber bolster or cement barriers. We will discuss more about this later in the semester. Car parking is not permitted in the lane, and curbside cycle lanes apply permanently, that is, throughout the day. The lane is desirably at least 1.5 meters wide on a typical arterial road, with a speed limit of 50 kilometers per hour. For those outside of a car and not on a bicycle, arterials through high-density centers or arterials flanked by strip retail development should, where feasible, provide wider footpaths, plantings, seating, and attractive lighting. Greater priority should be given to pedestrian movement, and this should include provision of mid-block pedestrian crossings at convenient locations, or what is also called a pedestrian refuge. Improved pedestrian facilities combined with other urban design features can encourage walking and, by doing so, add to the vitality and perceived security of the area. Consideration should be given to reducing traffic speeds through sensitive areas such as town centers and schools to improve pedestrian safety. Pedestrian crossing facilities should be located near to pedestrian movement desire lines where feasible. These can include curb extensions to reduce crossing distances, curbed central islands, zebra crossings, and signal control pedestrian crossings.
In general, a safe place for pedestrians to cross the road is at a well-marked, controlled location, often at an intersection. But in 2016, 72% of pedestrian fatalities occurred at mid-block locations, between intersections. So, how do we reduce fatalities at these locations and provide safe transportation for every pedestrian? Pedestrian refuge islands can be an effective option, reducing pedestrian crashes by up to 32%.
Pedestrian refuge islands are great. They are basically a raised area in the middle of the street where vehicles physically can't go. And they are intended to sort of break up the crossing.
The key is that it lets pedestrians cross the road in two sections.
By adding that pedestrian refuge island, it gives them a safety zone so that they don't have to cross six lanes of travel at one time. They can cross three, pause, wait till the traffic heading in the opposing direction is clear, and then cross through. It just gives them a safety buffer.
Refuge islands are ideal for crossings that traverse at least four lanes of traffic with speed limits of 35 miles per hour or greater. The refuge island should be at least 4 feet wide, preferably 8 feet, and marked with a high visibility crosswalk, lights, and signage. In-street stop or yield to pedestrian signs can also be placed in the median to remind road users of pedestrian right-of-way at an unsignalized pedestrian crosswalk.
All of which we'll discuss more later in the semester.